This has to be the smallest FDM printer that I have ever seen. This is the EasyThreed K7. And as small as it is, it's actually just enough if you are an absolute beginner, don't have a ton of space for these kinds of things, or if you have a very creative child that wants to get into 3D printing, but you kind of don't want to invest a whole buttload of money into it. Now, I cover a lot of different DIY crafty things on my channel, including resin printing, which I've done quite a bit of. Unfortunately, I've never actually dabbled much in PLA, filament, FDM style printing before. My husband does. He has two large machines, including the brand new Bamboo X1 Carbon. It's fabulous, but I really don't even know how to use it. So at least with this one, I was able to experiment, learn how to configure things and calibrate everything I needed to get good models out of it without really breaking the bank. And speaking from personal experience of face rolling my ADHD booty through a million different hobbies, I'm pretty happy with that. So the perspective of this video is going to come from an absolute beginner. I'm not going to act like I'm an expert. I'm not going to try to bullcrap my way through a review whatsoever. I'm going to go over the basics of the machine from my perspective as somebody who has never really used these things before. All right, let's hop right into looking at the EasyThreed K7. So the working area of this baby is gonna be 100 millimeters cubed, so about 3.9 inches cubed for those of you who enjoy freedom units. Leveling the build plate is actually kind of simple. All you have to do is basically take a sheet of paper, home the device down that has the nozzle. This is your head with the Z-axis. So you're gonna press the home button and it will drop it down. And then all you have to do is take the sheet of paper and put it underneath and just tighten or loosen the screws in the four corners so that you can basically level it such that that piece of paper has a little grip but can still move around. It comes with a magnetic little build plate here that's textured, but what I'll say about it is that it is basically just like this vinyl plastic, and I have had a really hard time getting some of the filament out of there. And the other thing is we had a little bit of a whoopsie, and the nozzle, while it was warm, was touching it, and so it melted it a bit there. So this is not terribly sturdy, but it does a good job, and we didn't actually have any issues with adhesion to the bed for those initial layers. The controls are really simple. You have a home button to bring the head down to the plate so you can do all your leveling. You have a switch here that will let you either feed new filament in, center for actually like using the filament, and then off to the far right here for extracting the filament. And then here you have your micro SD card. You put that in and essentially it's just going to print by default whatever has the latest timestamp. Then you have an LP1 port that you can technically plug in your computer, and I had it plug into my computer and it recognized that something was plugged in and turned on, but unfortunately I wasn't actually able to send anything to the device. Maybe that's because I lack drivers. I'm not entirely sure. And then of course, here's where you put your AC adapter. If we turn this around, you can see that you have buttons in the front. There's nothing else going on the other ends of the machine. But right here, you have one button that represents each of the corners. And as you press it, it will let it just slide automatically to where it needs to go. And I used that when I was basically doing all of the leveling. Now, when I have my micro SD card in, everything's plugged in, I've set it to go, then I can press the play button and it will start to warm up the nozzle and do the print. So it came in two pieces, really. Basically, I had to just take the Z-axis here and screw it in place. That was really it. And as far as taking the filament and putting it on, it's just this little plastic little thing here that snaps into place and just sits there. This is actually not something that comes with the machine. This is a miniature spool of PLA that we had on hand that my husband uses to test all of his toys. Now, if you want to use a more standard size spool, you can absolutely do that. I actually did a lot of the test prints on here by just like unraveling as much as I thought I was going to need and putting it around the one that's like with the machine. But then my husband surprised me with this lovely thing that he made. And as long as he gives me permission, I'll share the files below so you can print your own if you want one. That's basically it as far as the features go and going over like the exterior portion of the K7. So let's go ahead and start looking at some of the results. So included on the micro SD card are your slicers, including a proprietary one that they have provided. You don't have to use it. I actually found it to be a little bit on the buggy side, but they also include the installer for Cura. So I installed that and I decided to use Cura as that's more of like a industry standard kind of settings. They also provide this little test file, much like you would expect from any other brand. They do give you a test file that helps you calibrate and make sure everything is running without doing anything other than leveling and feeding in the PLA that they provided for initial test runs. This printed out perfectly. I didn't have any issues with adhering to the bed or anything like that. It's basically just a simple shuttle printed in vase mode. So it just does like, you know, the one loop around all the way up until it gets to the top. The one thing I did notice is it is a little bit blocky. You can tell that it was a low polygon model. So maybe if I slowed it down, it would be fine. That is when I decided to start grabbing the cubes. Right, so here are the cubes. This is cube number one, cube number two, and cube number three. So just using absolute bare bones settings with supports on, this is what I got, and you can see the supports really were glued in there. So that, at least to me, indicated that maybe the temperature was just a little too high. It defaults to 200 degrees Celsius, and I never was able to get those things out of there. It would have wrecked everything. It also left a lot of the brim down at the bottom, so not the best results, but at least the top of it looked pretty darn good. So that wasn't too bad. So with the second one, I changed out the PLA thinking maybe it's a filament issue. You know, filament can go bad if it sits out for too long, blah, blah, blah. So I tried some of the filament that my husband had and I liked it. I actually slowed it down quite a bit. Default, it was set to 50 millimeters per second to print, and I actually dropped it down to 25. So I cut it in half, and I didn't mind the results like at all. This one turned out really, really well. So what I did was I tried to take a happy medium and speed it up a little bit more. And unfortunately, that's when I noticed that it went back to looking a little janky in some of the layers. So I could see a little bit of bubbling, a little bit more of the structure underneath. So I think speeding it up was the bad idea and then slowing it down was fine. Also, just for giggles, I printed it super small. Look at how cute it is. That's so kawaii. Oh my goodness. But jokes aside, that's actually some really good detail. Okay, then I decided, you know, why not? Everybody does benchy. Let's do a benchy. So I put Benchy in there and I had it print, and I used the same settings I did for the second cube. So basically 25 millimeters per second. And I did drop the temperature just a smidge to 190, and I let it iron on the top surfaces. And that's actually not half bad. I mean, of course, if I were to use this for anything or, you know, give it to somebody as a toy, I would want to sand it down a little bit. But I thought it was pretty darn neat. If we take a closer look, let you get all those details in on the camera and then the, you know, all that fancy lighting. So you can see a little bit of issues here with pulling between the layers. And I would suspect if it has anything to do with speed or anything, the lift height maybe, lack of supports right there. You know, some machines, maybe they just don't handle those angles very well. Again, I'm not talking out of my booty entirely, because a lot of these things, they tie right back to resin printing. But all in all, I don't really think this is a bad benchy. One of the things I did notice was I felt like I could actually see the support infill. So, you know, I could see right in here some of the ridging for the triangular grid that's going in place to support the interior, because of course you're not going to print this solid. And I thought, well, maybe the walls are just a little too thin. So it happened to completely fall apart on me when I started to print a gnome. And the first attempt at printing the gnome, it actually just, like, the feet caved in on themselves. There were holes in the back area. And I was like, well, I'm just going to push the walls to 1.5 millimeters and see how that goes. And I am happy to say that I have a really cute looking gnome. And I printed this for my daughter, who is absolutely obsessed with mushrooms, gnomes, and anything cottagecore right now. If I bring that in a little closer, you can see the detail and how much nicer that turned out just by having the temp at 190, the walls at 1.5 millimeters, and then just printing it at a good slow 25 millimeters per second. I think if I had sped this up, then it probably would have peeled at the layers as it was trying to go around. Otherwise, I think it actually just looks fine. This was really cute. It didn't need a ton of support. There's still some in the back here where I just epic failed at removing the supports, but it's a very good looking figurine. So what are my honest opinions about this? What do I think of this 3D printer that is very small and less than $100? Well, let's examine and consider the market for this. The target audience is supposed to be absolute beginners, such as myself, or children. I think we've all seen from the video content so far that for a beginner, it's actually pretty cute and fun. I've had a lot of enjoyment trying to print things out the past couple of days and basically stress the machine out a bit. The only downside to it that I have found, honestly, is that build plate. I would love to have something a little more sturdy, something more metallic, not necessarily a vinyl magnet that I would put on my car. So let's approach that kid angle. I have children. My children are 12 and 15 at the time of recording this video. Would I let my kids use this? Yes, I would. But I think that the litmus test for this, for other parents who may be considering this for their children, is would you allow your child to use a hot glue gun? If the answer is no, you probably shouldn't consider this machine and you should look at something that is fully enclosed as a starter kit for your kid and 3D printing. However, if they are old enough to maturely handle a hot glue gun and not touch it, burn off their fingerprints and become a seamstress, then I guess you're fine. The thing to note here about that particular comparison point with a hot glue gun is that the only part of this machine that heats up is the nozzle. And that nozzle is easily accessible if you have a very curious child that likes to touch everything. So that nozzle is right there. The plate itself doesn't actually heat up, which is great because it's wide open and I would be concerned about my cats being absolute idiots. The other thing to consider when you're talking about age appropriateness for a machine like this is it does have exposed cables. In fact, the Z limit switch on the back is wide open right over here behind the PLA spool. It would be really easy for little Julie to start ripping out every cable or popping that off, and all of a sudden the machine isn't able to safely understand what its minimum Z height should be. Apart from the exposed cables, I actually think the build quality is quite nice and on par with what I would expect for a machine that's less than $100. This is something that I will be able to print small accessories for my smart dolls, that my daughter is going to be able to print little toys like that gnome, because she's obsessed with gnomes and she likes to design toys. It's really fun for her. Something as simple as like just grabbing Blender or even working in Fusion 360 Community Edition, she can do a ton of stuff. Heck, there's even Tinkercad. All of these things are really accessible tools that help your child learn more about the environment around them and getting creative and making their own toys. In fact, I'm actually going to be giving this to my 12-year-old who brought her friends over last night, walked into my room while it was printing, and said, "That's my new 3D printer." Well, now that my child is going to steal my one and only FDM 3D printer, feel free to like the video, subscribe to the channel, and leave comments or questions below. Thank you so much. I will leave a link to learn more about the EasyThreed K7 in the description of the video. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel. I have to say that twice because I'm contracted to do so. Not really, but everybody does it.